Okay, thank you all. Right, I'm also going to do a sort of intro where I also state that I'm also an artist. People also get confused because I've been programming since I was 8 years old, I'm now 40, so I'm 32 years of very intensive programming experience, and met several people from computer science sort of areas who just can't imagine that I'm not a sort of computer scientist. But I've sort of always been fascinated with the, you know, what you can create artistically with code. And this has sort of facilitated a long exploration into the deepest, darkest realms of you know, assembly code and you know, all sorts of very low level stuff. So, and I've mainly worked with a lot of video projection, which is lots of fun because you can digitally create projections and you can control light, which is as sighted people we get most of our inputs from light. You know, so if you can control light and you can project on things and modify that, then you can play around with actual levels of perception. And also robots, which obviously is kind of why we're here. So yes, artist residence, also part-time memo lecturer at Brighton Ravensbourne, and I'm the head of projective geometry at the Institute of Unnecessary Research, which is a sort of international group of artists and scientists who are sort of exploring their own particular areas of interest to a rather extreme level, possibly beyond what could be considered useful research. So what I'm going to talk about is kind of more a sort of technical overview of how the project works and how we've kind of approached it and the sort of techniques that I've used, which a lot of this will be sort of probably known to some of you in terms of the technology, but kind of I want to talk about how I approach coding as an artist, not as a sort of for the purposes of research or. So, as Anna said, this is the first kind of model of the My Robot Companion that we exhibited. And it's based around one of these, which are fantastic devices. And before this, I mean, as I'm sure some of you have done, you know, I was writing my own code to take video stream, like just a normal colour video stream, and you know, if you need to know where the people are in the scene, it's really difficult. And you have to do all sorts of like weird tricks to sort of figure out what's the background, what's the foreground, you know, is that a person? I don't know. It's the kind of thing about computer vision which people don't understand. You know, they don't understand because humans are so good at this stuff. You know, we can look at a blurry, horrible, nasty image and just go, yeah, there's the dog, there's the, you know. Whereas computers are so awfully bad with it, that when a device like this comes along, that solves kind of one very difficult problem, which it does, and, you know, to pick out people, to track them, to, you know, you can track the skeleton, and I just took all that code that I wrote and just threw it away, and now I just use this. Well, I didn't throw it all away because it still does some things that it doesn't. But it's a really, really nice solution. And it uses infrared lasers. So one of the three ports on the front sends out this kind of pattern of infrared laser light, which you can't see. The other camera picks it up and creates the magically creates the sort of depth image, which looks like this. This is kind of the raw kind of image. So the lighter colours are nearer, dark colours further away. And this has got user segmentation where it's able to say that's a person, that's a person, and track them across range. Which for a piece of art is lovely, because you know we can actually have that kind of cohesion of the user experience where for Harry, you know, we're thinking, right, somebody's coming into the room. It's like the scenarios we've been playing with in the robot house, but in an art gallery. You know. people are going to walk up to the robot, and they're going to stand there, and how far are they going to stand, and all these kind of things. And we're able to sort of collect and sort of play about this in a way that you can't do with any other kind of art. I mean, every kind of piece of art is interactive in a kind of wider sense. A painting is something that you have a physical, kind of interaction with, where you stand, what the lighting is, you know, it's all. But with interactive art, you can respond, and you can actually steer the kind of experience of the user. So once we've kind of detected that somebody's there, we stick a face detection algorithm on. And I'm using the Hall cascades, which are good fun. And it has the nice ability that obviously it can track more than one face. I don't know who these people are. These are just random internet images. But and part of the things that we do is we take these algorithms and we kind of explore what we can possibly do with them. So, I mean, to be able to pick up multiple faces, we thought, well, okay, so we're doing this kind of face stealing thing. If we can have multiple faces, kind of for free, because that's kind of how the algorithm kind of works, we can combine them, and we can have two people standing in front of the robot and present a merged version of their face. So it's kind of the algorithm actually helps steer the artwork and helps steer the end result. So we have, it really does steal faces because it's kind of, people walk up to the robot and they just stand there, they know there's a camera there. It's a kind of implicit submission to being monitored, to being filmed. You don't know what I'm doing with your faces. I'm recording all of them. I take a snapshot every 30 seconds to a minute or whatever it is. I've got thousands and thousands and thousands of these. I mean, they kind of look good in icon. If you blow them up, they look awful. Of all the exhibitions that we've shown, all the 40,000, 47,000 people at Science Gallery, we've got images of quite a few of those, you know. And it's kind of this implicit thing that people just enter into. They don't know. They don't know what I'm intending to do with these things, which isn't very much part of showing into it. But it's so there's a kind of identity kind of exchange. So this is the kind of head that we originally came up with. And this is a little tiny video projector, about this big. And it's put onto this kind of head where there's a mirror at the back. It projects onto the mirror, and the mirror projects onto this vacuum-formed face. And when you stand in front of the robot, it will turn to look at you, and its face will start to sort of change slowly, and at some point people sort of realize that's your face, and then they go, oh my god, that's my face, and then the robot says, I like your face. and another sort of slightly ominous overtoning kind of thing. Now, of course, these algorithms never work 100%, as many of you all know. The face detection, you get false positives. And in kind of research stuff, obviously that's a pain. But for art, that's great. I love false positives. I think it's fascinating when there was this point that we couldn't have predicted in the Science Gallery, where at a certain time of day, the sun would come through the window and illuminate a bit of wall, and the robot was convinced this was a face. And it would just lock onto this bit of wall and say, I love you, this bit of wall, every day for about an hour. And then you'd stand in front of it and it'd look at you and it'd steal your face, and then back at the wall. And just, it was like this little love affair that was kind of going on with the world. I mean, this is kind of an example of what a false positive would look like to the robot. So you can probably see there's a guy, you can kind of see where it's going wrong. There's kind of two eyes and the kind of mouth area. And this happens not that often, but it's interesting kind of when it does. And I realised this was kind of, you've probably seen this, I mean, this is kind of a known thing. This kind of it's almost creating its own kind of optical illusions. It's always suffering the same things that we suffer from, which is obviously not the aim of the algorithm. It's not the aim of the thing, but actually, in some ways, it's actually achieving a higher level of optical, or no, high level of sort of recognition than maybe we give it credit for. You know, but maybe it's just not so useful. So I quickly wanted to just cover this other project which I did, which has sort of informed the new robot companion. This was a project I did, which is like a sort of 1 week fast placement at Cardiff University, working with this artist called Paul Grandjean, who does lovely, lovely work with robots in a very, does with lovely artistic pieces. Check out the website, it's very, very good. And he wanted to, he's got this long-term project where he wants to build a feral biting robot to reenact, or sort of reenact, inspired by Joseph Boy's I Like America and America Likes Me, where he spent 3 days in a room with a coyote, a wild coyote. And this was so he could commune with, as he saw it, the true spirit of America. And Paul wants to spend, I don't know if it's 3 days, but he wants to spend some time in a room with a wild, feral, biting robot to experience the true nature of robotics. And we were talking, and I was saying, okay, that sounds like fun, that sounds like an interesting thing. So we got a SIP grant, and I spent a week down there, and this is the kind of development of the robot. And obviously it doesn't have any biting mechanism, so it's called Toothless. And basically it's very simple. It sort of will look around, if it sees people, it will go towards them because it's kind of investigating them. But it won't get, if you walk towards it, it will go back because it doesn't like to get too far. It's kind of got this idea of space. And it's got a favourite toy, as a lot of these things do. It's a blue balloon. And this is me playing with the blue balloon. It's looking a bit haggard because I've just been programming heavily for a week. But we got it all up and running. We got it like from scratch. And I was thinking about kind of how robots navigate and how they sort of make a map of their surroundings, and then there's obviously slang and things which are sort of currently used quite a lot. But I wanted to do something which was more kind of fluffy and a bit more like kind of memory. So this is kind of a little bit what I'm working on with the new robot companion, which shares kind of some of the same sort of things as Harry. I'm sure most of your desks look like mine. This is part of the development process once we can hack the head off. So basically, it's, as well as the vision stuff, obviously it comes down to control of servos, which it's been great doing this project because it's a really to get my hands on these things properly for the first time. And I'm interested in the kind of, because they obviously feed back information, and I'm monitoring this a lot, you know, I'm sort of monitoring it many times a second. And I'm kind of interested to sort of uncover how these things kind of work on the kind of, not necessarily trying to make them do things and then saying whether they failed or not, but trying to suggest to them that they do things, and then if they don't quite do things, then I'll still say that's a success. Because it is art, and I'm allowed to do that. So that's what I'm doing tomorrow. Well, today and tomorrow is actually programming the arms to do a particular thing which we're working on. This is the current state of Harry. Anna found this very high quality sort of shop mannequin. And we've chopped off the arms and replaced them with servos all the way down. And there's three servos in the neck. If you're wondering about the face, that's because I stuck a camera onto it. And so I'm working on this kind of vision system, which is part of this, this navigation sort of thing, where it's kind of looking around, it's got a very narrow field of vision, and it's just kind of looking around the room, looking for motion and activity and all the rest of it. This didn't start off very well. This is kind of what I sort of started with yesterday. And I had it sort of looking around, picking a random point to look at, which is quite nice aesthetically, kind of. But eventually we got to this kind of result, which is this is Harry's view of the robot house. You can just see Anna a bit distorted on the end on the side of that. I only had to stand there for about 20 minutes, so it's good to do that. So I'm going to sort of develop this more, so it's sort of that it will start looking around and looking for places of interest, and then sort of slowly hone down the areas that it's kind of looking at. Is my current plan for it.
I'm just wondering, are you interested in this image that's produced by the scanning, or are you interested in the behavior of the robot while it's scanning?
The scanning movement's not very interesting. I like the random gaze thing, because it's far more sort of, it's too random at the moment, and it looks random. So the idea is to maybe like have a scanning, initial scanning phase, at which point it will then start to hone down the points where it randomly looks at. And the most active points will be the points where it looks at most. And then obviously if people are actually moving, it will sort of scan for them. Because I think, you know, we have this robot in our home. This sits on our flat. And when it's on, it's kind of, it's looking around, it's sort of like got this attentiveness to it, which is you kind of feel that it's kind of engaging in your life, which is quite interesting. So what's next for this week? We've got more research participation, because we've been subjected to all sorts of interesting things with the eye tracking glasses. As I said, I'm going to be working on the surveys for the arms tonight, because we're showing it tomorrow, aren't we? So we'll get that done. Friday. Oh, no, the whole day. I thought it was good. And then we're preparing for the open day, which we've got some interesting plans for, which we hope you will come to. So we're blogging about it, and there's our Twitter, because we're also tweeting up various things. There's a Twitter hashtag, because